Amen. Turn to your Bibles, Nehemiah chapter 5. We're going to just look at God's Word for a few minutes. We're doing a series called See. And as you can see, we got some awesome changes in the building. We're not going to leave it just unfinished like that, but there's been progress this week. We pulled up probably about 100 pounds of carpet and about 300 pounds of dirt. When a carpet's laid for that long, you can lean it, but it just keeps pushing the dirt down below underneath sometimes. We lifted that thing up, and man, it was unbelievable. So it took a little bit longer than we thought to clean things up, but we're really excited how things are going to look. We wanted to make sure that foyer was kind of dark looking when you came in, and we really want to make it bright and welcoming. And so it's been quite a bit of changes. I appreciate all the staff for doing a little bit extra. Pastor Shelley's been helping, and Pastor Call, everybody's been pitching in. Sony cleaning a little bit. It's going to be a little bit extra cleaning for a few days, but we're excited how things are looking. This series we've been doing on Seeing, we've started off beginning of Nehemiah. He was made aware of some destruction of a wall, and things were pretty bad in his hometown, the family of God. And so he was a burden on his heart. It was amazing. God gave him an opportunity to not only get the time off work, but his boss actually provided all the funds and the resources to be able to rebuild the wall. There was some opposition. People didn't like it. They had a plan on what they were going to do. They prayed, and everybody got involved working on their own little bit. We saw last week there was some threats from the outside that people tried to discourage and tried to enlist other people to come against the people of God moving forward. And it was a big challenge. We saw the night vision goggles, being able to see and deal with the threat of depression and discouragement when we're doing God's will. But we're going to look in Nehemiah 5, another threat. Just before we go forward, I want to just, the Word of God is kind of neat. The reason why we take the Bible, if you're new here, why we read from that, because believe God's Word does a couple things. Number one, God's Word's like a mirror. When you read it, you kind of see yourself and things in your life, which maybe you didn't see before, or maybe you just don't want to see. It's those things that you, when you read it, you all of a sudden kind of think, wow, it kind of hits you where you're at. It's a mirror. But the Word of God also can be like a telescope. It can help you understand forward what things can be like when you see who you are in Christ and in God. And my prayer this morning, we're just going to open in prayer in a few moments, but my prayer is that you will experience both not only the Word of God being a mirror to you today, but also the Word of God being like a window or a telescope, helping you see the way things can be. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this Word. The Word of God that's given to us, that is living and active and alive. I prayed, God, today that as we hear and we read this Word, that you would open our eyes, first of all, that we would be almost like we are going into an MRI, that nothing would be hidden from you or your Word, that your Holy Spirit would speak and reveal and point to anything that is according to your purposes for our lives. Affirm things that are right and challenge things that need to change by your Holy Spirit. I pray as well that you would inspire hope and faith and expectation for the future as we reveal in your Word your desire to work in and through us as we gather together as one. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. This week, we're looking at another dangerous threat. Last week, the threat was an enemy from outside, and this week it was a rising up of an enemy within. People were halfway to their goal. They were doing pretty good, but as we remember last week, they started to get a little bit tired. They persevered through that, got their second wind, and the enemy started to get tired. The enemy outside started fading. Their attempts to thwart the plan of God were not being successful. But a new and potentially worse enemy was rising. Who is this enemy? Selfishness. I know, not a popular one. At least we're doing it on May long weekend, but not everybody has to endure it. But selfishness. If I can say one thing before we get any farther, just because as I read it and I've read over and highlighted this morning and prayed about it, but I can tell you it's not a very popular theme to preach on selfishness. And although I'm not going to be hammering it over and over again, there is really one application to this message this morning. For us to examine our lives and situations and circumstances and relationships that we've been in, where we have allowed selfishness to have a negative impact on our lives and those around us. Selfishness is a killer. Sometimes the result of pain and hurt, selfishness, can cause us to be self-focused because someone else has perhaps hurt us, or what someone has done or said, or because we didn't get our way, or because someone has abandoned us or rejected us. It has caused us to then lick our wounds or to be protective of ourselves. And that protection, that self-protection, morphs into not just being self-protected, but then being self-focused. And that self-focus then can move us from just being protective of ourselves, being defensive, to then being overprotective. And we move into something that becomes destructive for us and those around us. Satan's most effective weapon is brother against brother. We need to protect against the speck in the eye syndrome. And protect against destroyed relationships. Look at the back of the first conflict. You think of Cain and Abel, the source of all the jealousy, the feeling of rejection that my sacrifice wasn't good enough, the envy, the bitterness, and the result. We've been revealing a few results from the chat and vision sessions we've been doing. We have one coming up, kind of the final one, to bring all the consolidation between the staff and the board in a week. But one thing we've observed all along, way back when we started the process and doing the conversation cafes, we met together just to talk about where in the past was the right direction, and we tried to keep the thing focused and say, let's keep this on the positive, let's keep this not digging up negative or not digging up the past. And I'm a little bit sitting beside, we're just sitting in the family living room right now. If you're a visitor today, welcome. Apologize, we just have a little family moment here, but you're more than welcome to stay here and sit in while we have this moment. But from the very beginning, it became apparent, and it's not a surprise to me, that there was a propensity towards talking about negative. And no doubt, just like every family, how many, you've been in a family and you've had some bumps in the road as a part of being a part of a family? Anybody? Yeah, a few honest people. Healthy families are not families that don't have problems. Healthy families are families that deal with problems. That's healthy families. Well, unhealthy families are the ones that go, what problem? I don't see a problem. There's no problem here. Yes, there is. Dishes are flying. That's not a good thing in a home. So when we have situations that haven't gone so well, we can all look back in our past and think of things we could have said, didn't say, should have said, things we did, shouldn't have done, could have done. We can look at how things we do better, and probably now would do them better if we could do them again, but we can't do them again. And so every family has that, and the family of God is no different. The problem is if we don't deal with them right, we cause more offense, which then we don't deal with properly, which causes more offense, which we don't deal with properly, and we can spin out of control. And then we become preoccupied. Instead of the church of God moving forward and advancing the kingdom of God and loving their neighbor themselves and revealing the love of God that would send his son to the world to die, to a lost world, we're preoccupied with fighting each other. Infighting. So preoccupied that when we sit together to plan about future, all we talk about is past offense. I'm telling you now, that has got to stop. I don't know whether it's in the church or outside of the church. That's the same thing. We do the same thing in Welland. We were talking with a few stakeholders in Welland, the Niagara Region, City Council, and a few other people were getting together to talk about Welland and how we can make Welland a better place. And we were talking about how Welland has a bad self-view of itself. We talk about how John Deere used to be here and how other manufacturing pulled out and things aren't the way they used to be. And we talk about, but it's been a long time since John Deere pulled out. That's a long time ago. GE's coming in. Have you seen it? New plant, great news. We got some great stuff, some good things are happening. But you know what the problem is we don't talk about the good things that are happening. We reflect about the hurt of the past and the disappointment of GE, of John Deere pulling out or manufacturing pulling out. The steel industry is not what it used to be. We start thinking and charting a course for the future. We get preoccupied with the negative of the past. Even most recently, when we did the health assessment, there was a opportunity, and it was anonymous. We don't know. Everybody could answer the questions, about 200 questions that people that filled it out and sent it in. And we were able to consolidate all that information. There was also sections on an opportunity on each one to just share, even just if it's not been in the question, just something on a topic. There is not the majority, but enough to warrant comment of how many people bring up past offense. How they don't think that Pastor so-and-so was treated right, or they have a problem with someone else in the church, or the problem is the church is too this way, or the church is too that way. There's this lean and bend towards murmur and complaint of past offense. I'm telling you, it's the most powerful weapon. If there's one thing that's gonna thwart and weigh down the plan of God for your life, it's allowing this offense to work itself in and fester. It must be dealt with. So we're going to get there. I went a little way more into this than I planned on. So let me move out of here. While outside enemies had threatened to thwart the plan of God, it seems like, and you look at how fast Nehemiah dealt with this one, it seems like he was extremely concerned about the potential. Yes, you got some Kleenex ministry. I brought this up with them. Thank you very much. This is an ongoing Sunday ministry for you. Everybody has a place in the body of Christ. There's one right there. We need to repair and rebuild and restore. Enough fighting. My parents have a hummingbird feeder, and my in-laws also. You've seen them, right? Those little red, four little flowers on the outside. You've probably seen them. Fill them with sugar water and nectar, fake nectar or sugar water. The hummingbirds love it. I remember sitting watching as a kid and seeing them dart back and forth and back and forth. I began to watch it. Day after day, they'd come back and forth, hummingbirds, ruby throat, beautiful, watching them fly. Looked like they were playing. I discovered they're not playing. What it is there is one that's defending that feeder. There's four different places to eat off that feeder. But one claims that feeder as its own, sits on a nearby branch and defends that feeder with its life. Every time another hummingbird comes, it hardly is there for a second, and it chases it away. Not to have a drink itself, but to go back on its perch and to make sure no one else is able to take any of that nectar. Day after day, it's almost like their own little private version of Star Wars. You see, like, and they're like, and begin to see that they're not playing. They're fighting. It's an interesting illustration. You see, because that hummingbird that claimed that feeder as its own didn't buy that feeder. That hummingbird didn't buy that sugar, didn't pour that water, didn't mix that mix, and did not hang that feeder. That hummingbird didn't even do anything to earn that feed. It was my father that filled that hummingbird feeder. And yet, that hummingbird made it like its own. Wonder how much we as a people of God fight over it, what we have, hold what we have closely, complain when someone has what we has or has more of what we than what we have. We fight. We're gripped with greed or pride or envy. When everything we have or are that is good comes from a gift of God anyway, and none of us have earned it. But we fight over it. It's time to get off our branches and stop the battles. We need to put on safety goggles of humility and servant heart to protect against self-focusedness. Because the end result of being selfish is being tired and divided. Selfishness robbed God's people of their joy and their motivation, and it needed to be dealt with quickly. Let's read chapter 5. We're going to start. Most of the people sacrificed greatly for the cause of the whole. Now listen. Now the men and their wives raised a great outcry against their fellow Jews. Some were saying, "We and our sons and daughters are numerous. In order for us to eat and stay alive, we must get grain." Others were saying, "We are mortgaging our fields, our vineyards, and our new homes, to get grain during famine." A great outcry against fellow Jews. Now, many of the Israelites that came back to Jerusalem in Ezra's day were wealthy. They brought with them wealth. So what happened? How did things get so off? How did things get so bad? Well, partly they were sacrificing their time and effort and even some of their resources on rebuilding the wall. Those were committed to it. Others had mortgaged their land because of their focus. And others were so involved that they had set aside work they would need to do in the fields in order to commit to the work, a part of the greater project. And you might read this at first and say, "Oh, pastor's going to talk about debt today." No, I'm not going to talk about debt. I'm not going to talk about, this is not a financial lesson. Because if I talked about debt and finances, I would distract from the real problem of the whole issue. It wasn't about debt, and the issue is not about finances or being a good steward. The issue is selfishness. You see, the problem was, is they started to sacrifice themselves and giving of themselves to building the wall, and that was followed up with famine and drought and taxes and high interest. And all of a sudden, they found themselves in a desperate place. The wives are joining in. Everybody's crying out, saying, "We don't even have food. There's a lot of mouths to feed." How many have felt, and you know what it is, to feel the pressure of providing for those who you're responsible for? That's a big burden. That's stress. A lot of marriages. I do pre-marriage classes with couples when I'm involved in the big day, and we talk about communication. We talk about finances. It can be a big stress for families and marriages and homes. The "what's in it for me" mindset is highly destructive to the body of Christ and the family of God. When we were doing this vision process, every now and then there would be a comment, and this would happen more often, if you will, about, it's the "what about me?" And we were inviting information, but it's the, you know, things aren't the way they used to be, and they aren't the way I like them. or the pastor I used to like isn't here anymore, or a pastor used to do this and that was good, I liked that, and we don't have a program for me, or the music is not the way I like it. Preference. The my way comments. I know it's pretty quiet, but let me get me wrong. I mean, we're here to serve and to help. We have to be very careful to think that we're here. We're not here to make it about me. That would be wrong, right? Foundation to a very serious problem was happening in this day. There was a few people that had a what's in it for me attitude. And so when they saw everybody giving everything they could to build the wall, and they saw famine and drought coming up, it was demand. And there was a supply problem. And so they saw opportunity. So they bought up the mortgages. They lent money out to people that were in desperate times of need. Most people believe that the guys that were involved in doing this, you remember the guys of Tekoa, those nobles of Tekoa, the rich people of Tekoa, who, when everybody was doing their bit and working on the wall, Nehemiah mentioned, oh, and there was some nobles in Tekoa that didn't do any work on the wall. A lot of people believe that Nehemiah made that remark then because he was later going to refer to these guys as the guys that were now, not only are they not doing the work, and not making sacrifice, they're trying to profit on those who were. Still others were saying, we have had to borrow money to pay the king's tax on our fields and our vineyards. Although we are of the same flesh and blood as our fellow Jews, and though our children are as good as theirs, yet we have to subject our sons and daughters to slavery. Some of our daughters have already been enslaved. See, these guys, they were not just loaning out money. They were loaning out money at high interest. And then they were taking as collateral people's children. Instead of giving, they had found this as an opportunity to take. I don't have to help unless there is something in it for me. It wasn't so much laziness then, perhaps, why they didn't help when we looked at that earlier a couple weeks ago. It was more selfishness. Greed is one of the sins denounced before Babylon captivity. Isaiah warned against it. Jeremiah warned against it. Amos warned against it. And because they didn't heed those warnings, they ended up in the Babylon captivity. And it seems like they haven't learned their lesson still. Some of the people still have those selfish tendencies. And it's highly destructive to the family of God. Selfishness can destroy marriages, families. Selfishness destroys relationships, destroys business. Selfishness destroys churches, destroys communities, destroys countries. Selfishness is a destroyer. Sanballat and the army of Samaria, they tried to destroy God's people's plan to see the walls rebuilt, but they couldn't stop the project. But this inside threat posed a real threat. Why? Well, we see that it caused helplessness. Hopelessness settles in when selfishness takes over. But we are powerless, verse 5, because our fields and our vineyards belong to others. Now again, this is not about debt. I'm not talking about debt and stewardship right now. What I'm talking about is selfishness, because a few people were taking and thinking only of themselves and their future. Others were oppressed. God does not look at this lightly. We are powerless, the people of God were saying. Can I say, God did not save you and redeem you to just live through life as a victim and powerless? You are not powerless. You have the Spirit of the Almighty God that lives within you. You are made more than a conqueror. But I can tell you what, you can live in a way, and selfishness threatens our conquering way when we get preoccupied. Nothing is more draining than trying to deal with a selfish person. Keeping in with the bird theme, I don't know if you ever heard of the cuckoo. It's very common in Britain. In fact, it kind of signs. Have you been hearing? I love the birds of spring. You know, you see the flowers, but I like the birds. You hear them sing. I heard a blue jay the other day. I love the cardinal. We have a cardinal that love living in our couple of the trees by our house. I love the cardinal singing. You can see them, and you see them in the wintertime, every now in the backdrop of a pine tree with a bright red male and the female beside him. And you see them, but you don't hear them in the wintertime. In the spring, you start to hear them singing. In England, it's the cuckoo. And what's interesting about the cuckoo is when it starts to, spring comes, it starts to get ready to lay an egg, feels like egg coming on, it doesn't make a nest. It doesn't work to make a nest. What it does is it goes, finds a nest with some eggs in it that's been unattended with a male or a female bird, an adult bird, and it goes quickly, sits down, lands in that nest, lays its egg, and leaves. The warbler or the thrush, the smaller bird, returns back to the nest, and then it's not very good at arithmetic. Imagine if you go home today, you got sit down at the table, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, well, feed them all. And just like, well, we need to get a plate. Yeah, everyone, way to go to bed. You don't get lunches tomorrow. I'm going to make lunches. Got to make 3 lunches. 1, 2, 3. Oh, yeah, 4. Got to make 4 lunches, I guess. And suddenly you just start caring for 4. Some of you feeling like, I've had that happen. I mean, but so the cuckoo comes in to a nest it didn't make, lays its egg, and leaves. That's the extent of its parenting. This thrush or the reed warbler comes back, cares. Next morning, the smaller bird parent gets up early to get the worm, right? Flies out. Gets a word, comes back. Built in the maternal and parental instincts is to feed the offspring that are the most hungry. Well, guess which one that looks the most hungry and the most needy? The bigger one. And so here you have an adult that's a third of the size of the offspring, because the cuckoo has grown bigger and bigger and bigger. The warbler's offspring have gotten smaller and smaller and smaller, and eventually all three of the offspring of the warbler or the thrush bird perish. And the one fat cat gets fatter. Nehemiah knew this issue needed to be dealt with. There was a few that was feeding on all the rest. When Nehemiah became aware of this, he burned with anger. And he was ticked off. But he dealt with his anger and was able to deal with these few people. Verse 6 and 7. When I heard their outcry and these charges, I was very angry. I am so glad that he put that in there. I mean, this is, you know, Nehemiah writing down, he goes, man, when I heard that, I was ticked. I was mad. I was very angry, he said. I pondered them in my mind. Oh, I'll bet you did. You ever ponder somebody in your mind? I'm pondering you right now. When I heard about the charges, I was angry. I pondered them in my mind. And then I accused the nobles and the officials. Nehemiah steps into the scene and discovers the reason for the people's crying out. A holy anger grips him, and he deals with the situation. It's a pretty good example. The verse, I pondered them in my mind and then accused them. And the one version says, I mastered my feelings and reasoned with the nobles. I like it because there's a revealing of the way Nehemiah felt and dealt with his feelings. It's important that he take a few minutes and think things through before reacting. Because one of the tools of the enemy to perpetuate offense is reaction. Someone says something, it hurts us, and we react. And then thereby hurt them back. And we start in this negative, cyclical, we oscillate back and forth, tossing and hurling grenades back and forth. Sometimes with words, sometimes with just looks. Sometimes with lack of words and avoidance. We need to think, ponder, take a few minutes before we react, because reacting can cause a lot of hurt and harm. Master our emotions is a sign of genuine maturity. There's nothing wrong with Nehemiah's anger. In fact, I personally believe if he didn't get angry, that would be a problem. And if he didn't do anything about it, that would be a problem. It's just don't be reactionary. Careful in the way you deal with offense. An obvious question flows out of this. When you get angry, do you practice self-control so things can be moved towards a solution? Nehemiah was able to separate his own feelings or master them. And now it's time to deal with the issue. Now is the time for the difficult conversation. Now let me tell you, I've said this a couple times, we have to have difficult conversations. How many of you as parents have you ever had to have that difficult conversation? Ever have one? Yeah. I don't like to have those. But you know, we've got to have this conversation. If I don't have this conversation, things are only going to get worse. We have to have crucial conversations. But the way we do them, how we do them, matters. It was time to call off the work and get the community together for a word from God. Now, you know it's a big deal. They're on a time crunch. They want to get stuff done. But sometimes you got to just take the time to not get stuff done and just get everybody together because you got to have a family meeting. I told them, you are charging your own people interest. So I called together a large meeting to deal with them. Now, interesting, a little bit of Matthew 18 there. He goes to them and tells them, you're charging them? He says, I told them. And then he goes to a larger meeting. He calls the larger meeting together and said, as far as possible, we have bought back our fellow Jews who were sold to the Gentiles. Now you are selling your own people only for them to be sold back to us. They kept quiet because they could find nothing to say. That's one of those moments when you just kind of, you know, kick the ground and chew your cheek. Some issues cannot be ignored. I'm looking forward to a series that's coming up, I believe. I'm not sure exactly. We're looking at our summer and fall sermon series, and one that's been on my heart for a while because living in the Niagara region, just driving in the area, I see all the vineyards. There's so many vineyard references in Scripture. It just keeps popping out to me as I've been reading them. And so we're going to do a series coming up on the vineyard. Everything from, you know, the vine and the pruning of the branches and cursing of the fig tree and the parable of the worker that comes late and gets paid the same as the guys before. And so all the vineyard references through Scripture. And so as I was planning this, I was I've been doing a little bit of kind of pre-research and talking to one individual who's responsible. You think the owner is the most important one in a vineyard, and I'm realizing it's not. The most of one is the one who's manages the vines. It's the most important guy in the whole vineyard. I was talking about just some of what they're doing and the pruning, and he said, I was talking a little bit about the series, and when I mentioned about the cursing of the fruitless tree, he goes, oh yeah. He said, there's one thing that doesn't get tolerated. It's a vine or a fruitless tree. Deal with it. Why? His answer surprised me, and I'm going to tip my hand a little bit. It wasn't because that tree's not producing. That tree's supposed to give me this much fruit, and if I don't have that tree, then I don't have that fruit, and we don't make money. It's about making money. It's about producing. It's about production. It's about performance. It's not about that. It's about protection. Because fruit trees bear fruit. It's what they do. And if they're not, something is wrong. And if that fruit tree is not bearing fruit, then it is highly likely it has a disease or something that's contagious that bears to threaten the whole vineyard. And so they deal with it right away. Can we fix it? Can we deal with it? Can we heal it? Can we stop it? That's why they prune it back, to try to cut off anything that might be that offense. But one thing you cannot do, you cannot ignore a fruitless tree. You set it aside, you ignore it, hope it goes away, and the disease will spread. Nehemiah knew this attitude of selfishness, this attitude of me first, was something that could not be ignored, or it would threaten the whole family of God. He was in a precarious situation. Someone was right, someone was wrong. Someone had to be confronted, someone had to be rebuked. Someone was going to have to ask for forgiveness, someone was going to have to forgive. God's work, these walls were in jeopardy. It was time for a word from God, so he stepped in almost in a prophet role. And when he was done, finished with the evidence, things were so clear, they could not even defend themselves. The case of selfishness and lack of help was case closed and clear. This exhortation from Nehemiah was what was needed. Nehemiah, Warren Wiersbe says, was not a politician who asked what was popular, was not a diplomat who asked what was safe, but Nehemiah was a true leader and asked, what is right? It's a great question to ask. What is biblical? What would God want us to do? What is right? What reflects the heart of God? Nehemiah defined the damage these few selfish individuals had caused and called them to change their ways. So we have a cry that happens in the beginning. And track with me. The cry happens in the beginning. We help understand why, what was happening. The problem was that some people were being selfish and oppressing other people. And rich were getting richer, and the needy and the poor were getting more needy and more poor. And so Nehemiah, when he got all the facts in the case, he was angered, but got control of his anger, dealt with the situation, and confronted the individuals. They did not even answer a defense. And so when they did not answer any kind of defense, he responded with the consequences of what they were doing. Not just the consequences of their action, directly what would consequences for them, but the result of their kind of selfishness and what it was causing to the people and the family of God. I continued. What you're doing is not right. Shouldn't you walk in the fear of God to avoid the reproach of our Gentile enemies? I and my brothers and my men are also lending people money and grain. Very important point there. I'm going to get back to it in a minute. But let us stop charging interest. Give back to them immediately their fields, vineyards, olive groves, and houses, and also the interest you are charging them, 1% of the money, grain, new wine, and olive oil. With no word of response on their defense, he goes right into the next stage, which is saying, this is why this needs to stop, is because this is damaging the family of God. The biggest reason is the impact to the witness of the whole community. We're a laughingstock to the other nations. Our enemies would mock God if we continue to live this way. Nehemiah explains, being fair in business is okay, but taking advantage is not. You know, I have a love-hate relationship with social media. In one way, I love it. I love staying in touch. I had a birthday not too long ago. I heard from people that I haven't seen in years. Like, ah, wow. And genuinely, I mean, they took the time to say happy birthday, even though it was over social media. They didn't have to do that. They could have saw, oh, it's Jamie's birthday, whatever. So it's good in some ways. In other ways, I'll tell you what bugs me about it, though, is when especially the people of God, decide to air their dirty laundry about what they think about another church or another pastor or this sermon or that guy on social media. It makes us a laughingstock. We start criticizing others and one church. People don't make a distinction. They just think you Christians. That's all. They don't know. Whatever. Start talking bad about whatever. Wellspring, that guy over there, I can't believe that. I love Pastor Mark. Wellspring does a good work. We start criticizing other things that God is doing and out of jealousy or pride or selfishness. That's the motivation for some of those things. Beware of some of that, especially when we're talking about offense. Beware of airing your personal offense over social media. Everybody knows who you're talking about. And you know everybody knows who you're talking about. That's why you're talking about it. Because you want to get back at them. It's a little bit of revenge. Stop it. Revenge is not okay if you do it on social media. You are saying it when you say it. Even when you say it, with your thumbs. You need to stop it. Those are destructive things. Causes hurt, damage. Man, this is a hard one. I know. Why can't I get the fun ones? Okay, I got a fun thing coming up in a few moments. An exciting part. I got a video clip from the royal wedding. So be ready for that. I have a video clip from the royal wedding. Look forward to that. That'll make you... The only solution was immediate and complete repentance. To be fair and not be selfish. To be generous, to be giving. Because that's the kind of father we have. And the children of God need to reflect God. They need to confess the selfishness and move forward. Note, though, Nehemiah and a few others were also lending to people who had need. You see that there? So the lending, it's not the issue. It's not about you shouldn't charge interest or you should charge it. It's not about that. It's that thing had gotten out of control and a few were charging way too much and oppressing. And then taking children and people's children as collateral. So Nehemiah, in order to deal with that extreme, he opted out what was fair. Forgave what was fair for him to charge so that he would be free to deal with the extreme. Interesting leadership principle there that could go on, but we need to move. They acknowledged their guilt and restored what they had wrongfully taken. We will give it back, they said, and we will not demand anything more from them. We will do as you say. They acknowledged their guilt and responded with restoring and making things right. Talking about when things are wrong, I mean, this is a bit of a mirror part of the message. We're looking at areas where maybe perhaps we are being a little bit selfish or thinking of ourselves, an area where we maybe need to change. Chuck Swindoll says, when God shows up and shows his people a particular sin that they're guilty of, he doesn't tell them to take their time to deal with it. He tells them, deal with it now. When we realize we are doing something that's not quite right, now is the time to stop it. Making long-range plans to correct the problem does not work. It just means you tolerate that sin or that wrong more, maybe even to the extent that you would eventually protect it. Very powerful words from Chuck Swindoll. So, an oath was taken and heeded as proof of genuine repentance. Then I summoned the priests and made the nobles and the officials take an oath to do what they had promised. The priests were called to create an oath, called in the lawyers, make a contract, write this thing down. No offense, but done business with you guys before, we're getting this thing on paper. It wasn't just, hey, yeah, you know what, we're wrong, you're right, we won't make them pay anything back. Good, thank you, appreciate that that's just your heart and what you've said. Now I'd like to get that on paper. You ever had a situation that you didn't get on paper, you're wishing you did get on paper? I tell you what, this is a very important step in reconciliation and keeping unity. Very, very important step. Agreement. All our staff, when we sit down, we have a letter of agreement that has my signature on it and their signature on it. The board all have read this. It's just some expectations. And it's a letter of agreement. I give it to them. They look at it. They write it back. We talk. If they're saying, well, I was thinking of maybe having this day as my day off instead of that day. Is that possible? Yeah, sure. Well, whatever. I was thinking about coming in. We get an agreement of what the expected amount of hours and work that needs to be done. And when it's done, we agree on that. It's not dictatorship. I don't say, here's your days. And it's not a mutiny and whatever you want to do, laissez-faire, they can do whatever. It's, we get an agreement, write it down. And I'll tell you what, I'll just say now, and this church is no exception. Many of the offenses that happen between pastors and churches and boards happens because there has not been good documentation of agreement. I'll just say that right out. Now, asking for agreement and doing the work up front is very, very important. It protects unity. Having that difficult conversation before there's a problem is a way less of a difficult conversation than having it after there's a problem. He comes down and says, appreciate your heart. Glad you made this promise. We're going to get this on paper. Calls in the priests. They make an oath. Why? Because feeling bad and sorry is one thing, but there needs to be action. That leads me to the last one. We look at Nehemiah as an example. A godly lifestyle is just demonstrated with a respect for God and a heart for people. Verse 14. Moreover, from the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, wouldn't you love it, your name has tax in it? When I was appointed to be their governor in the land of Judah until his 32nd year, 12 years, neither I nor my brothers ate the food allotted to the governor. But the earlier governors, those preceded me, placed a heavy burden on the people and took 40 shekels of silver from them, in addition to food and wine. Their assistants also lorded it over the people. But out of reverence for God, very important point there, you can underline that if you find it, I did not act like that. Instead, I devoted myself to the work on this wall. All my men were assembled there for the work. We did not acquire any land. Out of reverence for God, he sets the tone of moral high ground as a leader. Tone of fairness, a tone of leading by example, a tone of not lording all of others, a tone of not even demanding what's rightfully yours, tone of unselfish lifestyle. Instead of receiving what was rightfully his, he shared, not a taker, but a giver. Here's the contrast. When a few were takers instead of being givers, Nehemiah was calling them back to being givers instead of being takers, out of a reverence for God and a love for people. Okay. So now we get to the royal wedding. How many watched the royal wedding? I watched some of it, and some of it I watched on YouTube. But this guy's message, man. If you don't get anything, you got to watch this whole message. on love is powerful. I mean, I don't know what I love watching more, watching him preach or watching the Royals watch him preach. Bishop Michael Curry from Chicago, 65 years old, he quoted Martin Luther King Jr., but he also quoted the Bible. 1 John 4, "Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God, and everyone whose love is born of God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love." I was watching this guy preach. I was getting goosebumps, man. I was ready to call up the worship team after he was done. Love can help, he said, and love can heal when nothing else can. Love can lift up and love can liberate when nothing else will. God is the source of love. Listen, just a couple minutes of his words on love and our Savior's love.
There were some old slaves in America's antebellum South who explained the dynamic power of love and why it has the power to transform. They explained it this way. They sang a spiritual, even in the midst of their captivity. It's one that says there is a balm in Gilead. A healing balm, something that can make things right. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. And one of the stanzas actually explains why. They said, if you cannot preach like Peter, and you cannot pray like Paul, you just tell the love of Jesus how he died to save us all. Oh, that's the balm in Gilead. He didn't die for anything he could get out of it. Jesus did not get an honorary doctorate for dying. He wasn't getting anything out of it. He gave up his life. He sacrificed his life for the good of others, for the good of the other, for the well-being of the world, for us. That's what love is. Love is not selfish and self-centered. Love can be sacrificial. And in so doing, becomes redemptive. And that way of unselfish, sacrificial, redemptive love changes lives, and it can change this world.
So here's the window. Look in the mirror, you say, there's some areas in my life maybe, and we gotta be careful of the way I've been unfair, or past I've been unfair. I've been focused on past unfairness to me. Here's the look forward. And it's a simple one. I believe God's calling us to love. God's calling us just to reflect his heart. We sang, good God, good Father, I'm loved by him. That's who I am. We need to be like him. Can't undo things in the past. We can't change them. We can't even fix them. But Nehemiah fulfilled the law that day, got a holy anger in him, but didn't hurt in response. Instead, he called his brothers, those close to him. He led an example of loving with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and loving your neighbor as yourself. He understood how just a little bit of selfishness can affect the greater group. But love, humility, selflessness, generosity is restorative. We have a restorative work that we're called to. Some of you, you pray for a restored marriage, restored families, restored homes, restoration in our community, rebuilding in churches, rebuilding, restoring in families, in businesses. Love, humility, selflessness, and generosity restores, empowers. So I'm calling you in response to this message today, similar response to last week, to close the gap. You see at the bottom of your sheet, a little blank says, this week I will reach out to and close the gap. Notice there I'm not being specific. I'm not saying it's just strained relationships, whatever it is. The thing about closing the gap is you don't have to sort it all out right away. We think like, well, if I talk to them, we're going to get in a big argument. Well, you will if you bring it all up again. Don't bring it all up. Think, let's get back to the facts. When did the facts ever get to you to where you need to go? They don't. What we need to do is just unconditionally, without selfishness, without pride, but with humility and generosity, extend love. Extend love unconditionally. Don't expect a response. Not trying to get them to agree, not trying to coerce, just, I'm going to close a gap. The gap might be there just because of busyness, might be there because of offense. I'm not sure why it is, but you look, someone that maybe hasn't been here, you've missed on a number of Sundays, somebody at work that's been off, or somebody that perhaps a neighbor you haven't seen outside, or perhaps a neighbor you used to be closer than you are now, and you know there's something that's in between. I'm not saying down the road you might have to have a difficult conversation, but it begins with extending out unconditional love. When we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Don't try to fix things before you extend love. Nehemiah 4:19, remember the disconnection of last week. The work is very spread out. We're widely separated from each other along the wall. When you hear the blast of the trumpet, rush to wherever it's sounding, and then our God will fight for us. I am sounding the trumpet at the gap of selfishness, the gap of the needy, and the gap of the hurting. I'm sounding the trumpet there. It's time to gather and to love one another. Would you stand with me? Look around. Take a moment to take your eyes off yourself and your past hurts. This is how the enemy makes selfishness such a powerful weapon. Because in looking at our own hurts and needs, we neglect the hurts and the needs of those around us. So I want you, as we sing this song, reflect on who God is. Make a transition as we sing the song. Think about who God is and what He's done for you. And then I want you to make the transition to say, God, help me to be more like You. Invite Him to open your eyes as we sing. But our good Father.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of why they think You're
you.
That part of that phrase, I've never sung it like that until this time because of the application of this message. He's perfect in all his ways. Right? That means, and I know this might come to a shock for some of you, I'm not perfect in all my ways. I didn't look over here because my wife sits over this way. Pastor Randy's not perfect in all his ways. Pastor Cuke's not perfect in all his ways. Pastor Swarwood's not perfect in all his ways. Pastor Schwint's not perfect in all his ways. You come from another church, that pastor's not perfect. Boards aren't perfect. Sunday school teachers aren't perfect. Worship leaders aren't perfect. Sorry, Jordan. We're not perfect in our ways. That's why we need forgiveness. That's why we need to forgive, because we one day will need forgiveness. That's why we need to be merciful, because every now and then we need mercy. That's why we need to be gracious, because we need grace. Church, if we can grab this, if we can free people from the chain of expecting them to be perfect and extend to them unconditional love, we can make a powerful difference. Powerful difference. Last week we heard that same call. I'm giving it to you again today. Remember the Lord who is great and glorious, and fight for your brothers and your sons and your daughters and your wives and your homes. Remember, that was just last week. He said, fight. And for the same thing, I have the same call. Because the enemy was outside, now the enemy's inside. And all the more, we need to gather in the area of the gaps. And we need to fight for unity for brothers and sisters and daughters and wives. Think of a way that you can extend love. Don't let selfishness win. Don't let bitterness win. Don't let unfairness win. Don't let pride win. Don't let offense win. And here's my finish, and you will definitely smile when I say this. Don't be a cuckoo. I told you. Don't be a taker. Be a giver. Provide even for those who don't deserve it. Bless you as you go. Go in love. Don't be a cuckoo.